All right, Prabir, thank you so much for joining us. Great to have you on the show. Obviously, food delivery clearly didn't slow down this quarter, despite cities reopening, restaurants reopening. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, hi, Emily, and thank you for inviting me. We saw encouraging trends in Q1. In fact, as markets reopened and as in-store dining grew, the negative impact to consumer behavior that we were initially anticipating was actually better than anticipated. And I think the reason for that is because consumer behavior tends to be sticky. So when new habits are formed, consumers have downloaded the app, they start using it, and those habits persist. And part of the reason for that is because the product has gotten materially better over the course of the past year. There's more restaurants on the platform, the delivery times are quicker, and that's helped us keep consumers around and coming back to the platform.
Well, I am a huge DoorDash customer, so I've seen the improvements in the product, wonderful customer service. The question is, does this keep up as the world truly opens up, the country truly opens up and people get more comfortable, especially with the new guidance from the CDC that vaccinated people can drop masks indoors?
Yeah, I'm actually so excited about that because, you know, we're rooting for restaurants and we're excited for them to succeed. But what we're seeing is these two things can coexist because people want to go back into the restaurants, but they also, you know, it's 25 times you eat during the week and not all of those are going to be in the restaurant. Some of them are going to be delivered at home. Some of those are going to be picked up on your way back to work. Some of them are going to be catered food at lunch when you're in the office. And so we're attempting to engage the consumer across all of these different use cases in order to ensure that that we keep consumer behavior robust, even as the markets reopen and restaurants reopen.
What segments and verticals are you seeing the most growth in? Like, can you give us any color on where the growth is coming from? You know, cities, suburbs, what kinds of restaurants, you know, any more you can say?
Sure. I mean, actually, we're seeing growth across the board. I mean, when you grow your top line by 222%, you know, it's not usually one area or another. And what's driving that is we're very early innings in terms of the penetration of these categories. So even if you take all of the food delivery platforms across the space, you know, just as a percentage of overall food sales, we're talking about a small percentage or a fraction into the overall food sales across the industry. When you look at convenience, which is another large category that we launched about a year ago, that's a $250 billion industry. Online convenience sales are, again, a tiny fraction, less than 1%, according to third-party data. Grocery, same dynamic. And so what you're seeing is given the low levels of penetration, there's a lot of room for ourselves and others in the space to grow. And that's what's driving the growth that you've seen this past quarter.
So let's talk about grocery. Uber's partnership with GoPuff, obviously Instacart gaining share. Grocery seems to be the next frontier. How are you preparing to take on the competition?
Sure. And, you know, the first thing I should say is we're very early in the grocery journey. That business was launched 6 months ago. But let me point to a parallel. We've got our convenience business that was launched 12 months ago, much after some of the other names that you mentioned. And even in that short duration of 12 months, we've quickly become the number one leader in online convenience, according to third-party data. And what that speaks to is the extensibility of our platform, the size of the consumer base we have amassed, our ability to engage those consumers in categories beyond food. And that's what's enabled us to drive our growth and be a market leader in convenience. And I'm confident that if we continue to build a product that meets consumer expectations of speed and quality and price, we'll be successful in grocery as well as the other verticals we add.
My DoorDash app often asks me if I want to pick up from 7-Eleven after I place an order. How popular is that? Are people often taking you up on that offer?
It's very early. We actually just launched that a few months ago, but we're excited by the initial results that we've seen. In fact, you know, from your perspective, from a consumer's perspective, there's no reason you should be concerned about which store something comes from. In fact, I was talking to somebody the other day that ordered a cake for Mother's Day and they wanted to buy a bouquet of flowers. You know, and this consumer didn't care that the flowers came from a different store than the cake. And so our product now allows you to mix and match across these different stores. And it's early and we're excited by the prospects there.
So there's still this looming risk about the reclassification of workers. We don't know what position the Biden administration is going to take on this. How concerned are you about that, knowing that it could go in a direction that doesn't necessarily help DoorDash?
Yeah, I think it's important to take a step back from the initial headlines that even Secretary Walsh said were perhaps taken a little far. In fact, when you read the comments and based on our discussions with the Department of Labor and the Biden administration, we're actually encouraged by what we're hearing because it signals a willingness on the part of the Department of Labor to engage with the private sector to determine a mutually acceptable solution to this important issue going forward. And so, you know, it's important that I reiterate that we will always advocate for what Dashers want. And what they tell us is that the number one thing they care about is flexibility paired with the benefits and protections they deserve. And so, you know, we're excited to engage with the DOL and the Biden administration on this issue. And hopefully we'll have an update to this matter, in the future.
All right. So clearly grocery is a big potential future area. What other categories could we see you explore or are you exploring?
Yeah, our mission is to enable all forms of local commerce. And so what that means is anything, any stores that exist in your community, we want to bring those to your doorstep. We started with the restaurant category. We expanded to convenience. We're now expanding to grocery. We're in alcohol. And so think of the range of stores that you might go to, and over a long enough horizon, hopefully you'll get all of those through DoorDash.
Meantime, you know, I know you're also working to support and continue to improve your relationship with restaurants. Can you tell us a little bit more about the three-tier pricing structure and how that's working?
Sure. Sure. I mean, maybe the first thing I should say is we consider ourselves a merchant-first company. And so we spend a lot of time talking to our merchants to understand what they want from DoorDash and how we can support them better. And the number one thing we were hearing, particularly last year, was the fact that merchants were often it was unclear to them exactly what we were providing at different commission price points. And so the objectives behind the pricing packages is to provide enhanced transparency, choice and flexibility in order to allow a merchant to choose the package that best serves their needs. So for a merchant that's trying to optimize for growth, you know, a certain package with more marketing support might be more appropriate versus a merchant that's optimizing for profitability. And so we've gotten great feedback. We tested this for 6 months. We launched these packages in April, and so far the feedback's been quite positive.